Welcome to Whaley's Chapel. I am so glad to see all of you here this morning. If you all stand and join me, we'll sing My Feet Are on the Rock.
I can see the clouds rolling. I can feel the winds, they try to shake me. I will not be moved. My feet are on the rock. Feel the waters rise. I can hear the howling lies that haunt me. Fear won't hold me now. My feet are on the rock.
When I feel my hope about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come.
Has anybody had an anniversary since last Sunday?
No.
I'm celebrating my mistake.
That's all right.
It's 7 years we've been today.
No others. Now on to our announcements. Our pantry items for the remainder of March are grape jelly and shaving gel and razors.
Also have a thing that they are always in need of t-shirts, male and female, different sizes. So if you see a pack of them, they're on sale, grab them. They always need those as well.
Always needing t-shirts. So, all right, and then our jobs for children's church today, and that's for 6 years old and younger. And then our jobs for children's church for the remainder of the month. And then revival starts tonight at 6 p.m. And then Monday through Wednesday, it will start at 7 p.m. And our speaker will be the Reverend Kirby Winston. and there will be some special singing each night, so please come out and join us. Gotta come out for me, because I have to be in Greenville, so please come out for me. All right, and then Bible journaling on the third Tuesday of each month, and that will be starting April 19th at 7 p.m. at Miss Jennifer Whaley's house. Are there any other announcements?
I've got one.
Yes, ma'am.
Right now we're going to do for the ladies in the auxiliary, planning to do it on April the 10th at 5:45. That way we can have full meeting that night. So our tentative plan is to be here at 5:45 and do our program for, and then we'll go into our
meeting. All right, sounds good.
Unless something changes, we're going to lose. That's the tentative plan.
All right, sounds good.
We thought that would be a good plan, because any other time it was going to be after Easter before we could get it in. So that's why we decided we were going to try to do it. Usually, the Sunday school council meeting is through plenty of time if we can do that before court comes.
Are there any others? I know Mr. Bryan has one.
Our grocery chute that we have every year is going to be on April 30th, so y'all put that on your calendars and come out and support our Layman's League and Women's Auxiliary, because they'll be having breakfast there as usual. Just come out and fellowship and bring some money and your guns.
Sounds good. What time is that?
Shooting
starts at 9.
Yes.
1, 8, Lane's gonna be out here at 7. Those people will probably be out here at 6.
So just show up any time that morning. Somebody will be here. That's what I'm hearing.
Other people's money.
Sounds good. All right, Mr. Bryan.
How's everybody this morning? Yep. You know how I feel about Sunday school. All I can tell you is invite a friend. I'm kind of partial, because my class, we were rocking this morning. We had good conversation this morning, and just so many things that we can learn while we're in our Sunday school. And I'm up here this morning because there's somebody involved in our Sunday school that keeps us all going, and she fed us breakfast this morning, got her daddy to cook, brought the kids out to eat. And I'm telling you, we had such a wonderful time. I'd like to call Miss Wendy up this morning. This is who I'm talking about. She's our superintendent, and she keeps us busy. And we are so fortunate to be in this church this morning and have a Sunday school, because there are churches that don't have Sunday school.
That's right.
And it's because of her that our Sunday school is so good.
It's not because of me, it's because of y'all.
Thank you so much. God bless you.
Alrighty, if you'll all stand and join me and turn your hymn books to page 155, we'll sing Revive Us Again.
Hallelujah.
service. Are there any names that need to be mentioned at this time? Yes, sir.
Mr. Charles, he came by our house the other day with Jeffrey, and he seemed not like he was doing better, but
he was kind of fine. Oh, that's Mr. Charles. Yes, ma'am. Joanne Williams.
Yes, ma'am. Family of Robert Turner.
Family of Robert Turner.
Remember Doris Bostick and her family from the Billville area. She lost her son Darren this past week. I think it was Tuesday, and it was unexpected. And also remember the Marty Blizzard family.
Right. Yes. Awesome. Are there any others? If not, raise of hands for silent requests and Pastor Bonnie.
I would ask you to please keep Reverend Kevin Jackson in your prayers. Your brother Kevin was with us some time ago, our revival speaker. He's having some problems with his diabetes. He said this COVID had just about killed him. He didn't have COVID, but he had to stay home. He said the refrigerator was right there. Made it kind of tough on him. They've got him on a new medication, and he said it makes him so sick. So he is having some problems, so just keep Brother Kevin in your prayers. Let's go to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we come in your presence again this hour, Lord. Father, we always come to you with very humble hearts because, Father, we know we're so unworthy of the great blessings that you continually pour out upon us, those blessings, Father, that we are so unworthy of. Father, we know it's just through your grace and your love and your mercy that you've extended salvation to each and every one of us. A salvation that's so full and so free, Lord, that all we have to do is believe on the resurrected Son of your precious Son, our precious Savior, Jesus. Just believe, Lord, it says. We shall be saved. And Father, we believe that with all our hearts this morning. And so as we've assembled here as your children today, Lord, we again just offer praises up to you. But at the same time, Father, we offer up our request to you, Lord, for those that have been mentioned that stand in need of your healing touch, Lord. Whatever that touch may be, we pray you would just suit a blessing to each and every one of them in this hour, Lord. If it's heart problems or cancers or viruses or just whatever it might be, Lord, we leave it in your hands now. You're the great healer. We know that, Father, so we just pray you'll take them in your loving arms and gird them up, draw them close to you just now, Father, and bless them in every way. For families who are bereaved, and there's many around us as we think about them today that have lost loved ones, Lord, that you just bless them, that you comfort them, give them peace that passes all understanding, Lord, that peace that we can only dream about because we don't understand it. But Father, we pray you'll gird them up also and give them strength. And Father, let them know that you're in control, that your will is being done, that things will be done as you wish them to be done, Lord, in most cases. So Father, we just thank you again for these blessings, and for those maybe who are traveling this weekend, we pray for traveling graces and mercy. Father, that you would bring them back in our midst again before it's too late. But most of all, we think of those who do not know Jesus Christ this morning, Lord, because they're in the worst shape of all. They're the sickest of all. They're the most displaced of all. Because without Lord, without you, we know they're lost and are nothing. So, Father, we pray the day will be the day of salvation. Today will be the day that you touch those hearts that they may open up and that your precious word may enter in before it's too late. Father, continue to bless this church and our outreach ministries. Father, just lead us and guide us in all our undertakings. Keep us in your will, Lord, and we come for praise and honor you in all things. We pray this in the name of our precious Savior, Jesus, and all of God's children said, amen. Amen. Amen.
All right, if you'll stand and join me once again and turn your hymn books to page 228, we'll sing Footsteps of Jesus. It is now time for our tithes and offerings. Would our ushers please come forward? Mr. Bobby, would you please bless our offering?
Heavenly Father, we approach our song of praise this morning. Lord, we thank you for the many wonderful blessings that you've given to us. We come back this morning, Lord, to your portion of that which you have given to us. And Lord, we ask your blessings upon it. It might be useful to spread the gospel and uplift the name. In Christ's name we ask. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. No, I'm trying to get my stuff together.
Let's make it work, okay? Just because I haven't had enough today. Just wanted to sing that song. And I could hear her this morning when we were singing. Praise the Lord.
Today we're going to talk about secret treasures. A secure treasure. You're the adult.
I'm the adult, okay.
Hey, what's wrong?
We unpacked some of my boxes from storage, and my teddy bear had mold all over him, and holes, and he was a mess, and some of my other stuff was messed up too.
I'm really sorry your stuff was all messed up.
Yeah, me too. I wish I had a box that would have protected it from everything.
Wow, that would be nice. Then you could go put all your favorite things in there.
And nothing would ever be lost or ruined.
Only thing is, it's hard to hug a teddy bear in a box. The things you really like, you want to have with you all the time.
Boy, that's the truth. I sure miss my teddy bear while he was packed away. Guess I will still miss him.
Gosh, I'm sorry. Are you going to get a new one?
Nah, it wouldn't be the same. But thanks for caring. Somehow that makes me feel better.
I'm glad the things that matter the most can't be destroyed by fire or mold or stuff like that.
What are you talking about?
Well, you know, friendship, caring for each other, love, things that God gives us.
Oh, yeah. I do have a lot of friends. I never thought of them being a treasure.
Yeah. So there is lots of stuff God gives us. Love, joy, peace. Patience, kindness.
Oh, yeah, we learned about all that in the Bible.
Yeah, he gives us the Bible. He also gave us Jesus.
Oh, yes, I remember that from Christmas.
Yep, the most important things come from God. Hey, I remember a scripture about that. Here, let me read it to you. All right, so Matthew 6, 19 through 21.
Which... looks like Skip didn't prepare to have that ready for Annie to read, so. But it's great, and we'll read it later, won't we, Annie?
Yeah.
Here you go, Skip. Hey, you're going to read something that, oh, and a matter of fact, he does have it. It's right here, Annie.
Good job, Skip.
I found it for you.
Thanks, I appreciate it. Okay, so, here it is. Don't store up for yourselves treasure here on earth, where they can be eaten by moths and get rusty, and where thieves break in and steal. Store your treasures in heaven, where they will never become moth-eaten or rusty, and where they will be safe from thieves. Wherever your treasure is, there your heart and thoughts will also be.
Wow, that is a safe place to keep your stuff.
Yep, no one can mess that up. When we live for God and know God, we have a treasure that can all be stored and never be taken away.
The best treasure is protected by God in heaven. Right? That's it. Right? So all these things that we can keep on earth, right, they don't mean anything, right? Because they'll all fade away. Our clothes get... I put on a favorite pair of jeans the other day, and I was like, oh, they feel so good, until my foot ripped the knee out. Right, and it didn't matter anymore, right?
That's the style.
It is a style, but not for me. Right? So, I might be able to sell them now. So,
they can put a patch on.
They can give it to grandma and she'll. But that's what we do, right? So cherish the love we have for the Lord the way we cherish some of the things that we may own, right? And the last thing I'll tell y'all is, what is grief but love perseverance? Right. That's what that is. Love all the time. All right. Smile, everybody. It's a good sunset.
That's all the time.
Clear.
This is the third Sunday of Telethon week, month, excuse me, with leading up to next Sunday being Telethon Sunday. I'll get it out in a minute. So I hope you're much in prayer for our foreign mission field. Brother Harold and Sister Sandra will be leaving tomorrow morning, I understand, be flying out tomorrow morning to be in the Philippines for a couple of weeks, I think. It will be visiting our churches that are there. A lot of destruction in the Philippines from the whatever they call them over there. We call them hurricanes here, but anyway, typhoon, that's what they call it, yeah. It was several of our churches that were completely destroyed that were there. And, of course, our churches are not like our church buildings at all. Most time they're shelters or something like that they meet under. But it costs a lot to rebuild those because those are some very, very poor people that are ministered to there. So without anything further, as we look at week three, and we'll see what they have in store for us today. busy ministry going on in Mexico also. A lot of churches there. I'm not sure over the last 2 years if they have been able to do their annual mission trip that they've done for years and years down to Mexico. Usually they go down for a couple of weeks with volunteers that can go, and usually will build a church during the period they're there. Literally build a church building while they're there for the folks to worship in. As you can see, they had some pretty decent buildings that they are able to worship in there now, and got some good people leading those churches. Most of them have been highly educated as far as biblical education is concerned. Several of them have their doctorates, and you know they're doing a good work. And the Bible school it mentioned was where they are training other men and women into the ministry. So it's a good thing going on there. So be much in prayer for that mission field. Yesterday I had the privilege of going, well, before I start, we are 7 minutes into spring now, just so you know. I believe it said 11:33. We're supposed to be spring, so it's about 11:40 now. So we're into spring. I can hardly wait. I'm tired of this cold. Anyway, yesterday I had the privilege of going over to Macedonia Church and worshiping, really, with some of the ladies from the auxiliaries. And I had a good time. Sister Linda Herron was the speaker, and she told one joke. I've heard this joke told in a different way before, but she told me before I left, she said, "You've got to tell that joke tomorrow." I said, "Yes, ma'am, I will." So I'm going to tell you that joke. She said, this couple have been married for, say, 50-something years. Never had an argument. Never. So in talking, one of the men said to the husband, says, "It's hard to believe you have been married 50-something years and have never heard an argument. How can this be?" He said, "Well, it's simple." He said, "We got married, went on our honeymoon, went out to the Grand Canyon. And said, while we were there, she wanted to take the burro or donkey down into the Grand Canyon." He said, "So we did." And said, along the way, that little donkey stumbled that she was on. So she stopped, got off, and went and whispered in the donkey's ear, and come back and got back on him, and they went on down a little ways farther. It wasn't long before the little donkey stumbled again. She got off, whispered in the donkey's ear, got back on. It wasn't very far before the little donkey stumbled again. She reached in the backpack, pulled out a gun, and shot him. The man said, "Why did you shoot the poor little old donkey?" "Yeah, he don't know anything. He was doing the best he could." He said, "What did you say to that donkey anyway?" She said, "Well, the first time I just leaned over and said, 'That's one.' Said the second time I leaned over and said, 'That's two.' He said, 'Well, why'd you shoot the donkey?" She said, "That's one." He said, "We've never argued." I thought, I can understand that. This morning, for a few minutes, I want us to look at Paul. Paul is one of my favorites, I'll just put it that way, in the New Testament. He did such wonderful work for our Lord once Jesus slapped him down. I'll use that term. Once he got his attention, Paul became one of the greatest, I think, missionaries that the world's ever known. Our scripture will come from Acts 20 this morning, which we'll get in. I'm not going to read all that. We'll get into the verses as we go along. And our time is drawing short already, so I may have to try to cut little bits and pieces out. But sometimes I can't do that. So if we're late, a lot of you had breakfast, I know, because you were back there with me, and I ate way too much. So if we go to 12:31, it won't matter there. Anyway, we'll be here for revival tonight that week, won't we? All right. You know, a song that a lot of churches used to sing, and it seems like we have here, not too far in distant past, a song entitled, "I Shall Not Be Moved." And, you know, it goes something like this: "I shall not be, I shall not be moved, I shall not be, I shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the waters, Lord, I shall not be moved." It's a good thought, good song, but the problem is many of the saints of God are singing that song, but they're not like a tree that's planted by the waters at all. They're more like marbles on a Chinese checkerboard. They just get moved all over the place. They're not stationary. They're one thing today and something else tomorrow. You don't, when you meet them out there on the streets, you don't know where to say good morning to them or duck, because you don't know what's coming next. You don't know from one time to the next when you meet somebody, I'm afraid. Paul was a great Christian. As I said, once the Lord got hold of him, Paul was a great Christian. He was a man of conviction. Nothing got in his way. I guess if we could put it in our terminology today, we'd think it more of core values. He had strong core values. And when a person is motivated by those kind of values, those core values, if you will, they will live a certain lifestyle. They won't be moved, in other words. Their life will be dedicated to God each day. Won't be any different. Monday will be just like Sunday. Instead of Sunday being like Monday sometimes. So as we look at a glimpse of Paul's life this morning, we'll try to do it quickly. Some things I want to think about. First of all, was his sincere service. Paul's sincere service. You know, how we seek to serve the Lord is very important. It's obvious as we read about Paul there in the New Testament, he served the Lord because he loved the Lord. He served him because he loved him. You know, so the lives of so many people, I'm afraid, today, as we look around, those that are professing to be saved or professing to be Christians, they see it almost as a duty, as a job, rather than something good. As you look at the workforce of our nation, and boy, is it a mess these days, the workforce of our nation, there are a lot of good employees out there. They're there on time. They give a day's work. It's more than a job to them. But then you've got those that are there maybe on time, part of the time. They'll get there when they can. It's a job. It's a job. That's all it is to them. A paycheck, if you will. A bad employee. All show most of the time. So how we serve does make a difference. Brian, had you rather have somebody that's going to be there on time every day, that's going to give you a day's work, get done what's got to be done, or somebody that's griping and complaining all the time and might get there or might not? I mean, that's a pretty easy call, isn't it? But that's what the Lord faces every day when he looks at us. There are some who are giving their all day in and day out, and then there's others that see it just as a job. Yeah. It says, I've got to love the Lord, so I'm here. It says, I should be on church on Sunday, so I'm here. Where are you Sunday night and Wednesday? Think about that. Yeah. Kind of like the man said, he went in a fast food restaurant. He didn't say what kind, and I'm glad of it because I wouldn't want to go there. He said as he walked up to the counter, the girl behind the counter looked at him with his old snarly voice and frowned face and wondered what he wanted, and he told her. She served him, and in a few moments, she herself came from around the counter with a hamburger and a large soft drink for herself. And just about the time she got to him, she dropped her soft drink. So she just kind of kicked it aside, went back and got her another, and went and sat down and ate. Didn't bother to clean it up. He said it was very obvious to him. She was just there for the job. Just there for the job. That was it. Nothing extra. He said, I'll not be going back there. I wouldn't either. But think about this. Do we serve the Lord like that many times? When we drop our drink, do we just go get another one? Don't bother to clean up the mess we've made. Don't bother to try to straighten things out. Do we just kick it to the side and go on? Is it just a job or is it a calling? Is it a job or a calling? We need more Christians like Paul. Look how he served the Lord. He served in humility, it tells us. Acts 20 and 19. Paul was one of humility. He said, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears and with trials that happened to me through the plots of the Jews. Now, Paul had all right to be proud. He could have been a very proud man. But he said, He served the Lord with humility and with tears, he said. Paul was well educated. Acts 22 and 3 says, he said there, I am a Jew born in Tarsus in Cilicia, but brought up in this city, educated at the feet of Gamaliel, according to the strict manner of the law of our fathers, being zealous for God, as all of you are this day. I'm told that would be the equivalent of a degree from Harvard today that Paul had from the education he received there. Paul was a member of the Sanhedrin. I guess you could put him on equal footing with today's Supreme Court as far as how he was recognized. But the Bible says he served the Lord with humility of mind and with tears. John Ruskin once said, I believe the first test of a truly great man is his humility. The first test of a truly great man is his humility. Now, there's been a whole lot of people throughout history who regarded themselves as superior to others. The one that comes to my mind most quickly, I think, is Hitler. He tried to convince the Germans that they were the superior race. Pride. You know, when we have that mindset of pride like Hitler displayed, I think we're more like Satan than we are at any other time. When that pride becomes so strong in our lives. But when we have humility like Paul had, I think we're more like Christ then at any other time. When we're actually humble. Proud society in which we live. Think about the people around us. So proud, they buy houses they can't afford. Stacy knows all about that, I'm sure. They buy houses they can't afford. They buy cars they can't afford. They owe everybody. And we ask, why are they doing this? Pride. They're too proud to live that humble life, if you will. They want to be better than other people. You know, saying it used to be real popular was keeping up with the Joneses. I remember Vic said one time, don't try to keep up with me. You're going to be way behind if you do. At least they want to be average, if you will. And I probably told this before, and this was way years, many, many, many years ago, when they started building, or right after they built that huge housing development right across from White Oak High School, right in Jackson. Huge. Huge housing area in there. Juan and I were just out riding one day down that way, and we just had never been here, so we turned in there. There was Cadillacs sitting in the driveway. There was boats as big as the house, and house about three times the size they needed. And I thought, where are they getting the money? Then I thought, well, that's before Stacy came along. From Stacy, probably. Yeah. Yeah. Stamp them, send them on their way. There you go. Pride. They got to be as good or better than the Joneses. Now the Bible, think about this. The Bible doesn't teach us that we shouldn't think highly of ourselves. Ooh, you're thinking right now, I believe it says that in the Bible somewhere. Not that it doesn't. In Romans 12:3 it says, for by the grace given to me I say to everyone among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think. It's okay to think highly of yourself, but not more highly than you're worth. That's what it amounts to. Paul knew the perfect balance, and that was serving the Lord. He knew the perfect balance. He was willing to admit when he was wrong. Have you ever worked or lived around somebody that they were not going to admit they're wrong? There are people like that. They are not going to admit they're wrong. Paul did. Paul admitted when he was wrong. He'd tell you right up front. Messed up. I've had to do that a lot of times in my life and still do. Paul was humble, I believe, because he had a lot to be humble for. He was willing to admit when he was wrong. For example, Paul was wrong when he was a sincere Jewish believer. He persecuted the church. He persecuted the church. He was wrong. Acts 9, 1 and 2 says, "But Saul, still breathing the threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus so that he would be found, so that if he found any belonging to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem." Paul was sincere, but he was sincerely wrong. He was sincere, but sincerely wrong. Acts 8, 1 through 3 said, "Paul approved of his execution," speaking of Stephen, "and there arose on that day a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem. And they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Devout men buried Stephen, made great lamentation over him, but Saul was ravaging the church. And entering house after house, he dragged off men and women and committed them to prison." So as a Jew, he ravaged the church. But now as a Christian, he was willing to admit he was wrong. He was willing to admit he was wrong. Sincere, but sincerely wrong. That's a great characteristic to have. To be able to say, "I'm wrong, I'm sorry. Let's look at this from a different angle. Let's do something differently." Think about our schools for a moment. How many problems would be solved in our schools if children would just admit they're wrong? Most of them are never wrong. 2 and 2 is 5. "That's right. Yeah, that's right. You can't tell me that's wrong." How about our homes? If families were willing to admit when they're wrong. Or how about our churches? When people admit, "I'm wrong. I made a mistake. I made a mistake." We need to admit. We need to get rid of that pride, get humility in our lives. Paul served with tears, it says there in verse 19 again. "Serving the Lord with all humility and with tears." When does a person shed tears? When does a person shed tears? Many times they're tears of joy. I love those kind of tears. You have tears of joy. But so many times they're because something or someone has hurt you that you shed tears. There's very few tears in most churches anymore today. I can remember as a young boy, as I was traveling with Mom and Dad, as he was pastoring different churches around. I have seen, I didn't understand it back then. When people would go out that church door on Sunday morning, their eyes were glistening with tears from the service they had just been in. There were tears of joy most of the time. There may have been some tears of being hurt or grieved or whatever, but the tears of joy. But so many people today can't or don't shed tears except when they don't get their way. Their selfish way, if you will. Paul served the Lord, the Bible says, with many tears. He was like that tree planted by the water. He was not going to be moved. Secondly, he had sound speech also. Folks, it's very important that we walk it. That we don't just talk it. It's easy to talk it. Paul walked it and talked it. Tells us his teaching was profitable. In the 20th verse, he said, "How I did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable and teaching you in public and from house to house." A lot of people, a lot of preachers, let me back up there. A lot of preachers claim to love people, the people of God, but then they shrink from preaching the truth many times. Why? Job security, in some cases. They shrink or hold back. Why? Because that's what people want. People don't want to hear the bad stuff. They want to hear just the good. How it makes me feel good. You ought to be crying when you go out the door because your feet hurt. Or you've been stomped. Not because you've been patted on the back. They don't want to hear what they need to hear. They want to hear what they want to hear. And that's all. And that's all they're going to listen to. It doesn't really help anybody to hold back the truth from them. It doesn't help them. A counselor. You know, if you go to a counselor, if that counselor's going to do nothing more than say, oh, yeah, I understand. Yeah, it's going to be okay. I'd hate to have to pay $100 an hour for that, or whatever the cost might be. If I'm going to a counselor, I want to tell me what's wrong. See if I can straighten it out. A good parent knows if they're going to raise a child as they should be raised, they've got to confront them with the truth. My daddy's truth was about that long and about that wide. He got my attention real quick. And I'm glad of it. And I am glad of it. Acts 20 and 27 says, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. Paul said, I didn't hold anything back. I told it just like it was. Whether you like it or not, that's what you're going to hear. And that's the way a lot of the old-time preachers used to be. They didn't care whether you liked what they said or not. Heard one guy that was, he's just an evangelist. And that's not a good way to put it. He is an evangelist. He doesn't pastor a church. He does revivals all over the country. I said, well, you know, I don't understand that calling. I'm glad some people have that calling. I don't really understand. He said, well, it makes it easy. I said, what do you mean? He said, you preach the same sermons every week. He said, but the good thing is I can tell them just like it is because they can't fire me. I said, you go, brother. You go, brother. But Paul's ministry was not secretive. I'm afraid I do occasionally tune in some of our TV evangelists because I just kind of keep up with what they're talking about today, you know, where they are today. And when I look at some of them, I think, well, their message must be a secret somewhere because it sure ain't public. They ain't said nothing about the Lord or about repenting. Why? Because they ain't what the people want to hear out there. And they're millionaires. People are pouring money into them because it's what they want to hear. Paul's preaching was private. His teaching was private in some respects. It says in verse 20, from house to house. So not only was he in the synagogues or other places, he went house to house preaching. One-on-one, if you will. I'm afraid too many preachers there are just interested in crowds. Interested in crowds. How big a congregation do you have? Somebody asked me that not too long ago. I said, big enough. Big enough. I said, it would be wonderful if we had more people. But I'm not praying for more people. I'm praying for souls. I'm praying for souls. Paul ministered to the crowds, but he also ministered to the individual. And his teaching was without prejudice. Testifying both to Jews and to Greeks, it says. He didn't care who you were. He was going to preach to you. Didn't make any difference. It didn't matter what color skin they had, what nationality, what part of the country. None of that made any difference. Paul was going to preach to you. He cared about preaching God's word. His teaching was pure. Verse 21 says, testifying both to the Jews, to the Greeks, of repentance towards God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. He preached repentance. Pure repentance. He was preaching to that proud, rebellious people around him, trying to bring them down off their high horse, if you will. He wanted them to realize, you are a sinful creature. You need to repent. Need to repent. I'm afraid today we have this easy believism. I'll use that term. Easy believism. You don't need to repent. Just believe. My Bible doesn't read that way, folks. My Bible doesn't read that way about believing. It says we must believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. But we've got to repent. We've got to turn around. We can't continue as we're going. Paul was not going to allow the pressures of that time to persuade him to do anything different. He told him flat out, you got to quit your sinning. You need to quit sinning. Show some remorse for what you've done. So we saw he had sincere service and sound speech, but he also had a strong stand. Served in humility and tears, it says. Speaks words of truth. The greatest need, I believe, of our churches today is to find men and women like Paul who will stand for what's right, no matter what. They're going to stand for what's right. Paul was under all kind of pressure. If you look over in Acts 20 there, verse 22 and reading, it says, and now behold, I am going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. Paul said, I'm going to Jerusalem. I have no idea what lies ahead. All I know is the Holy Spirit said, be ready. Be ready. Put it in my words. For whatever may happen, just be ready. Paul says, I'm going. Nothing's going to stop me. I'm going. Not that he was looking forward to suffering, except he was going to suffer for Christ. That was all. He said, none of these things are going to move me. I'm like that tree planted by the waters. Nothing's going to move me. He was selfless. Selfless. Verse 24 says, but I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself. In other words, my life means nothing to me, is what Paul was saying. My life belongs to Jesus, and that's it. He was going to follow the Lord's leading no matter what. His striving, verse 24 again, but I do not account my life for any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel, the grace of God. That was Paul's whole plan. His whole aim, to finish the course of ministry that God had laid before him. And then in verses 26 and 7 says, therefore I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all, for I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. In other words, if you go to hell, it's your fault. I've told you about it. If you go to hell, it's your fault. That's what Paul was saying, because I've given you everything I've got. Paul was not going to be moved. He had purposed in his heart not to be moved. 2 Timothy 4, 7 and 8, he says, I have fought a good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, excuse me, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who loved his appearing. I like that. Paul said, henceforth, there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness. But it didn't just stop there. That would have been a proud statement, wouldn't it? But he goes on to say, not only to me, but to all who loved his appearing. Praise God. That's us. That's us. Now, I don't know what heaven's going to be like other than what a little bit it tells me in the scriptures. But my hope is one day that I get to stand in front of Paul and some of these other great men that began the church, if you will, got things rolling, to just talk with them. Maybe have Peter preach to me. Boy, wouldn't that be fun? I don't know what heaven's going to be like, except that I know I'm going to meet Jesus face to face. That's going to be the good part. It's going to be the good part. But the only way we're going to do that is repent and believe. Get that pride out of our lives. Get humility. Be humble. Be humble and tell it like it is. I don't care who you're talking to. Tell it like it is. As Wendy comes for our closing hymn this morning. Take the name of Jesus with you, page 424. If you have a need in your life this morning, I invite you to come. Give it to the Lord. He'll take care of whatever problems you got. It doesn't matter. He can take care of them. He will take care of them. May not be just like you want him taken care of, but he'll take care of them. That's the good part. So I invite you to come this morning as we stand together and sing 424. few moments up front? Sit right here. Brother Jerry has come this morning seeking to be anointed and prayed over for whatever you want to call it. He has to have a little surgery coming up for melanoma, so we'll be much in prayer about that. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for your blessings upon us. We thank you, Father, for Brother Jerry and what he means to us, and Lord, what he means to you. And Father, we pray as he's about to undergo this treatment, Lord, whatever it might be, that Father, you would just take care of it. That you just handle it in only the way only you can, Lord. Father, we know what our prayer would be, but Father, your will be done. Whatever it might be, Lord, just bless him now. Bless his family. And we pray in the name of our precious Savior Jesus. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Amen. I got a good God. I tell you, I got a good God. Let's stand together. 6 o'clock tonight. Well, 5:45 tonight. We'll be meeting in prayer for a time of prayer, so be here if you can at that time. Hopefully, Brother Kirby will be here by then. He was going to come this morning, and Wayne talked him out of it. No. He thought he was going to be preaching. I said, you should have told him to come on. But anyway, I think it helped him. He didn't have to get up and leave Myrtle Beach quite as early that way. But anyway, Brother Kirby will be with us this evening, Lord willing. I'm looking for a great time with his messages and the special singing we've got lined up. And just so you know, I am 6 months ahead. I've got one night lined up for singing for our fall revival. I'm usually running a week behind my week, but yeah. Young lady sang yesterday. I didn't know she could sing. Didn't even know her. Didn't know who she was. Known her mama for years. Stumpy Quinn's daughter. She sang yesterday. That young'un can sing. And she ain't a young'un because she's already retired. She's about to retire. But anyway, she is looking forward to being with us on the Wednesday night of our fall revival. I told her John Hill was going to be here. She said, goody, goody, goody. Anyway, I just thought I'd throw that out. Just you can go ahead and mark that down. That's going to be September the 11th through the 14th. I believe the date is that. Isn't that correct? That Brother John will be with it. September the 10th, Foreign Christ will be here to sing for us. Then we'll start revival on the 11th, and Brother John bring our revival. And got to get the other three nights lined up for some singing there now. Maybe get John to sing one night. I don't know, because he can do that too. But anyway, be much in prayer for our revival during the day. Be praying for it. Now, like I said, we'll have prayer room about 5:45. Just get us in that revival spirit to begin with before Brother Kirby blasts us with whatever the Lord's laid on his heart. All hearts and minds clear. Let's look to the Lord for a benediction. Heavenly Father, thank you again for your blessings. Thank you for this time together. Bring us back in that next appointed time. In the name of Jesus Christ, we do pray. Amen.